Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. I received a question in the group where a member of the group posted something, some note that is being circulated on the social media, WhatsApp, Instagram, Facebook, and so on and so forth. And the message is about Islam. Does Islam respect other religions? The person that wrote the note says, Islam is never respectful towards other religions and kufri isms. Why? Because only Islam is truth and other religions are falsehood. Truth cannot mix with falsehood. Tawhid can't respect kufr. Islam and other religions will never be treated equally because Islam has come to win over all falsehood, not to walk side by side with other batil religions. In Makkah, Rasulullaah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never respectful for the religion of mushrikeen. If he was, why the mushrikeen went against his life? A kafir is only allowed to live with Muslims when he has accepted the superiority of Islam by giving zizya, tax between brackets. Only then he gets equal right, but not equal respect like a Muslim. This person here that has written these three paragraphs, and from what I see here, is the why is just written a why. It's like an internet talk. Cause is just C and Z, it's not cause. So they use some terminologies that are only used by teenagers and kids on the internet. One. Two, this person here makes a huge big claim because when he says Islam is never respectful towards other religions, this person speaks on behalf of Islam. And this person hasn't produced one ayah from the book of Allah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not be respectful, so Islam be disrespectful. And this statement is actually a huge error for the following what I'm going to be saying here. And I will also mention at the beginning of my talk here, this is the essence of Wahhabism. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, in the books that they have written and the books of history and everything, have considered anyone that does not follow his own way of thinking as not Muslim, and that's why the murders and killings of thousands of people on different tribes took place. Again, I have made this talk on the internet. You can go to YouTube and look for something where I speak about Wahhabism, and you will get more details about that. But I will just mention a couple of the examples where Islam, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to be respectful toward other people's beliefs, even though Islam is completely different than these religions. So here, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-An'am, that is the surah number 6, ayah 108, where Allah says, وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, and insult not those whom, those disbelievers, worship besides Allah. Why, ya Allah, shouldn't we insult their beliefs? Because Allah says, فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, lest they insult Allah wrongfully without knowledge. Let's say we are somewhere and we see somebody worshipping a tree. Worshipping a tree is a wrongdoing and Islam categorically refuses that. But am I allowed in the name of Al-Islam to go and insult the belief of the other person and the tree and start having a go at them and what they believe? Absolutely not. Because Allah says, وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, do not insult those deities that these people worship besides Allah. Why? Because if we do that, then if they turned around and insult Allah, then we have committed the sin. Then the onus is upon us. So what does this mean is, if we see people in the church, in the synagogue, wherever they are, worshipping whatever they were worshipping, I should not be disrespectful to their religion because they will retaliate and be disrespectful to Allah. and we will be the reason and the cause as to why Allah has been insulted. And this ayah is in Al-Quran. This would have been sufficient that Al-Islam, and I will here now answer this person here when he speaks about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, in Mecca, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was never respectful for the religion of mushriks. But what this ignorant person doesn't realize is throughout the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not insult. He told Quraysh that what they believe in, as the Quran mentions, is the falsehood. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not disrespectful at all. Wasn't he known as the trustworthy, reliable, the best of noble characteristics and everything? So how was he disrespectful? Did he break any of their idols? There were over 350 idols inside the Kaaba and around the Kaaba. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, within the 13 years that he was in Mecca, he kept performing his salat, making tawaf around the Kaaba with all these idols within the Kaaba and surrounding the Kaaba. If he was disrespectful, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would have cursed these statues. He would have done something. He would have thrown rubbish on them. But there is a difference between attacking and being disrespectful to somebody's disbelief, like when they worshipped all these idols and everything that we believe are wrong, and keeping in your heart that it is wrong and you do what you believe is right. And that's exactly what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said and did. He did not. Hubal is the most gigantic idol that Quraysh worshipped. It was like a huge, gigantic statue. But Rasulullah ﷺ used to pray towards Al-Kaaba, and Hubal was there in the heart and center of it. I'd like to meet this ignorant person, this freak person that has written these three paragraphs, and ask them, if truly what you say is true, show me one example where Rasulullah ﷺ was disrespectful. There is a difference between debating and arguing an argument that what you believe in is wrong. If I see somebody worshiping a tree and I argue with them that someone can come and cut the tree, burn it and make anything out of it, well, that is an argument. This is different from being disrespectful, and that is going and, for example, and pee on the tree or just throw some rubbish on it. The person that has written these three paragraphs in the name of Islam has committed a huge problem. And this person here, if they catch him in the street and beat him up because of what he has written, then he will call on human rights and the freedom of belief. How can you request freedom of belief when you do not even agree to respect other people's beliefs? How is that possible? Islam is never respectful towards other religion and kufriism. Who told you that? Who told you that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it explicitly clear in the Quran that the people that we should fight are the people who fight us. If an army gets to fight you, then you fight back, you retaliate. Allah says, لَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ لَمْ يُقَاتِلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. Allah does not forbid you to deal justly and kindly with those who have not fought you on account of religion, i.e. there was no fight, no wars between you two. And also, وَلَمْ يُخْرِجُوكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ. They did not drive you out of your homes. These people, we are not allowed to launch any wars or have any wars with them or anything. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to be good to these people. تَبَرُّهُمْ. Al-birr is to do all kinds of good towards these people. Obviously, the scholars of Islam from the old days, and I will say this to you, have invented a huge innovation that is called the abrogation. النَّاسِخ وَالْمَنْسُخ. The abrogating text and those texts that are abrogated. In Al-Quran, my dear sisters and my brothers, and this is a huge problem you are facing today, anything that does not suit any scholar will tell you it is abrogated. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, he didn't say not even a single word that this is abrogated. Nothing at all existed at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ, and even at the time of the companions, who they every time they tell us you should go back to the book of Allah and understand it as the companions understood it. But the companions didn't have something called abrogated and abrogated. Today, my dear sisters and my brothers, with one ayah in Surah At-Tawbah, and they call it the sword ayah to save. They have abrogated over 128 ayah from the book of Allah. They made these ayah, these texts from Al-Quran, redundant. And the problem is this. The ayah exists in Al-Quran. The ayah is recited. We read Al-Quran every day and every night. In Ramadan, some people finish it off. When you read the Quran in your book, you find it there. So the ayah exists there. But what that means is, even though the ayah or the text in the Quran exists, but their meanings are completely useless. So if they are useless, how can we follow a book where part of over 200 ayat and more, the ayat are completely abrogated? They mean absolutely nothing. And this is a dangerous game that the scholars of Islam until today, Ibn Baz, Ibn Uthaymeen, Al-Munajjid, especially the Wahhabi world, anything that does not fit their agenda is abrogated, and you will see here. For example, the ayah of Allah subhanahu does not forbid you to deal justly with those that have not fought you. They say this has been abrogated. It is no longer valid because the ayah of a safe, of the sword. What they also mean, any ayah in Al-Quran where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to people, for example, وَانْتَظِرُوا إِنَّا مُنْتَظِرُونَ. So wait, we are waiting with you. Wait until the word of Allah comes. Wait until the punishment of Allah comes. They say all these ayat, even though they are written in Al-Quran, but they actually have no existence in real life. They are abrogated with what? With the sword. Instead of telling people who do not believe in Allah, wait until you die and you go on the Day of Judgment and meet Allah, to them what they say is, you must fight them with the sword. It's either they believe or you kill them. In other words, what our scholars of Islam have been saying for the last 1400 years is this. It's either people believe or we kill them. And they take texts from Al-Quran, they take them out of context to justify their sayings. My dear sisters and my brothers, in all honesty, do not be surprised that the non-Muslims say Islam was spread with the sword. Islam is a religion that is not accommodating. It's a religion that does not tolerate other people. And we cannot tell them you are wrong, because our scholars have tons of fatwa like that. Ibn Baz, in his website, or what is kept of his website, the Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia, has written pages upon pages as to why we must, not should, we must hate the Jews and the Christians and the disbelievers. Basically, what Ibn Baz says and his likes is that Muslims must hate the entire earth until and unless these people become Muslims. Is this what the Quran says? No. So, but when we go back and tell them, but Allah says in Al-Quran, they smack you back with, oh, that ayah is abrogated. It no longer is valid. That ayah has been abrogated, nullified, and completely wiped out by the ayah of the sword, i.e. kill people. This is why Daesh and ISIS and Qaeda and all these people kill non-Muslims, and to them they think they are doing something great and they are getting close to Allah, because this evil belief exists that Islam is never respectful towards others and the non-Muslims to us are nothing else but people that must be killed and get rid of. This is the truth of the Wahhabism. And why do I say Wahhabism? Because Ibn Taymiyyah made the errors before in giving tons of fatwa that had justified the killings of so many Muslims in his time. That's why Ibn Taymiyyah ended his life in jail. And he was taken to jail and died in jail because the scholars of his time had taken issues against him. to the rulers of that time, the king, the khalifa of that time. And these scholars won the argument against Ibn Taymiyyah, and he was put in jail, and that's how it ended. His student Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, who is also one of the pillars of Wahhabism and the Islam we have today, who spent 16 years as a student for Ibn Taymiyyah, when his teacher died, Ibn Taymiyyah, people exiled Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah and they put him on a donkey with him riding on the other side, i.e. the donkey facing forward, but Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah riding the donkey on the other direction, looking at the back. He didn't even know where the donkey was. Ibn Kathir and many other scholars were prosecuted and chased because of those extreme beliefs that have existed back then. The beliefs of Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah were kept under the dust for centuries. Came Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, who revived the whole thing of Ibn Taymiyyah, and because of the understanding and science and the how Ibn Taymiyyah perceived Islam, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, based on the text of Ibn Taymiyyah, had ruled that the Muslims at that time were kuffar. This is why nowadays, when you hear people speaking about Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, they tell you when he came, the kufr was spread in the peninsula. There were a lot of kuffar, and he came and he fought the graves. Absolutely not. This is an over-exaggeration to justify his evil, murderous deeds. Even in the books of history that he himself, i.e. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, supervised, he used to call himself the Muslims, and the other Muslims, including his brother, his father, other scholars, they used to call them al-mushrikeen. Al-mushrikeen means people of shirk. And these are people who fasted Ramadan and they didn't have the shirk as the Saudis would want you to believe. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, and Surah At-Tawbah is the last huge big surah that was revealed. And to the scholars of Islam, especially those the Salafi wave of people, they say the Tawbah, the last surah, is the surah that came and superseded, annihilated, nullified all teachings in previous ones. Any teachings in the previous surah of the Quran, of the entire Quran, where Muslims are to be kind and passionate and compassionate, all these things, these ayat are abrogated. So much so that قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ, the very famous surah that we all recite, and it's sunnah to recite in Fajr, and all these things, they say the ayah of the sword has nullified the meanings of قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. What this means is we recite قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ and it doesn't mean nothing. We cannot act on it, and we don't even get reward for it. And this is how Muslims have made of Al-Quran a tennis game. What they like, it's okay. What they don't like, it's either annihilated, it's either abrogated, it's even the scholars say this and say that, and the Quran has become just an empty book. Rasulullah ﷺ never said this ayah abrogates that ayah. And in his time, Al-Islam was perfected. Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenakum. We all will know this ayah. Today I have perfected your religion for you. Wa Atmamtu Alaykum Ni'matu. And I have completely fulfilled my bounty upon you. This is Allah speaking. Wa Raditu Lakum Al-Islam Deena. And I have agreed submission to Allah as the religion that Allah has agreed for us. But today we found people that tell you when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, that was al-Islam, that was perfectly, completely, and everything is beautiful. But after he died, we have sciences like the abrogated. No, we cannot. You see the problem we are facing today. Every time we say that ayah, they say it's abrogated. Who said it's abrogated? It's only a human being, a sheikh. And even the scholars of Islam do not agree on what parts of Al-Quran are abrogated and what others are not abrogated. There is a boxing match between them too, the groups of scholars. But what they tell you is ayah to save, the ayah of the sword has abrogated any part of Al-Quran, where Al-Quran is friendly, is tolerating, and all these things. And absolutely, this is rubbish. The person that has written these evil three paragraphs is not even an Arab. And it's not even a person of knowledge, because the way they write Y, they just write the Y, the letter Y. Cause it's just like a C and Z. And the way they talk is some kid in a bedroom who is completely brainwashed with Wahhabism and Saudism. I don't call it Salafism, I call it Saudism. And this person here has read the books of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, because what he has read here, I can smell the Wahhabism 100 miles away from it. Especially when he said in Mecca, Rasulullah was never respectful for the religion of mushrikeen. Otherwise, how the mushrik were against him. Yes, subhanAllah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca never ever said anything from him. What Rasulullah conveyed to Quraysh in Mecca is in Al-Quran. Where in Al-Quran Al-Islam is disrespectful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he talks about the idols and all these worship deities that they worship? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them practical examples. Allah tells them, can they answer your dua? Can they defend? Can they? Allah didn't, there is not an ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this dog of idols that you worship, those losers, those nothing made of rock and rock, dogs pee in them. There's nothing of that. Al-Quran uses beautiful wordings to refute what people are believing or doing. But Allah gives them what? The choice. Because on the day of Al-Qiyamah, Allah holds people responsible for their choices. Another example. In Am al-Wufud, towards the end of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about 5 months before he died sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, different tribes, different groups came from different parts of the Arabian Peninsula. Some of them came to check out this person that they heard of. Some others have accepted Islam because someone took Islam to them and things like that. There is a part in Saudi Arabia that is in the southern part of Saudi Arabia, and that part is known as Najran. It's even existing until today. That part there, it had Christians. There were Christians living in Najran. These Nasara Najran, the Christians of Najran, went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to visit him, and they want to see what does Al-Islam have that is different to what they had, Christianity. So one day Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam finished his salat. It was Asr time, and he finished his salat, and then he saw a group of Christian monks and priests and rabbis and all these different people. They were beautifully dressed. Some of the companions said, we've never ever seen anyone smart and beautifully dressed as these people were, and we never saw anyone after them as beautifully dressed as they were. But anyway, these people here got to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they walked into the masjid. And when they walked into the masjid, the time for their salat, they had a prayer before the sunset, between, not the sunset, but it's kind of like an hour. It's after our Asr. When their salat time came, what they did, they started praying where? Inside the masjid, inside the mosque of Rasulullah ﷺ, when they just prayed Asr. These Christians believe that Jesus is Son of God. These Christians believe in the cross, and these Christians still make the sign of the Holy Father, the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Son, the way they go from the head to the middle of their chest to the right and left. They still did that sign. So when they started praying, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood up and left, and then he said to his companions, da'uhum, let them to their business, i.e. let them pray. And so what they turned to the east and they started praying. This is what Ibn Kathir alayhi rahmatullah reported in his book of Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah alayhi rahmatullah fi ahkam ahli dhimma, when he wrote a book about the rights of the people who live under the citizenship of a Muslim country, and also in Zad al-Ma'ad, a very well famous book of Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah. The very sad news is in Zad al-Ma'ad they only take the prophetic medicines, which by all means doesn't exist, but because Rasulullah just used the medicines that people were using at his time. There is nothing holy about it. Okay, but anyhow, so that incident there If Rasulullah was disrespectful, if Islam was disrespectful towards other peoples, why would Rasulullah allow these people to conduct the salat 4 to 5 months before his death, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And the other thing, didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say to Rasulullah sallam, wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alamin, and we only sent you as a mercy to mankind, to all men? Well, for the Wahhabis, the Saudis, and the scholars, they say Ahl Sunnah al Jama'ah, to them this ayah is no longer valid, because the ayah of the sword has abrogated the meaning of that Rasulullah is sent as a mercy to mankind. You see the danger of how our scholars decide now what of Al-Quran is valid and right, and what of Al-Quran is no longer valid and no longer true and abrogated, finished, and all that kind of stuff. This is absolutely, and let me introduce to you this ayah of a saif. What is this ayah of the sword? In Surah At-Tawbah, well, this is Surah number 9, in the ayah number 5, there are about 5 ayat in Al-Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Muslims to fight, to go actually in a war, to war and fight. Allah says, فَإِذَا انْسَلَخَ الْأَشْهُرُ الْحُرُمُ. So when the sacred months expire, what should happen? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْثُ وَجَدْتُهُمْ. Kill the mushriks wherever you find them. And then he says, وَخُذُوهُمْ, i.e. catch them. وَحْصُرُوهُمْ, and besiege them. وَحْصُرُوهُمْ وَقْعُدُوا لَهُمْ كُلَّ مَرْصَدْ, and sit in ambush for them everywhere you can. And then he said, then فَإِن تَابُوا وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ, then if they repent and establish a salat and pay a zakat, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَخَلُّوا سَبِيلَهُمْ, then leave them alone, because now they are Muslims. Surely in Allah ghafur rahim, for Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. So what they say is, because Allah in this ayah says, catch them, besiege them, and sit in ambush and kill them wherever you find them, they said Allah has declared war on all non-Muslims, on all the kuffar. But the problem is, our scholars never ever took the time to categorize who is the kafir as Allah wants it, not as politics want it. When Banu Umayyah, Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan, when he wanted to distract Muslims from what he did and the murders and the killings and the huge evil that he did to Ali and everything, what he did, he created something called al-jihad, to go and conquer other lands. To do that, he needed some kind of justification, Islamic justification. Who gave him that justification? The employed government sheikhs of that time there, they justified for him. People are in their countries, and Muslims took the armies and went to these people, and they tell them, you let us give the dawah. And people say, why do I let you give the dawah? And they say, if you don't do that, then we will declare war on you, or you pay the jizya, i.e. al-jaza, as a reward for our protection. And this person here, this idiot who wrote these three texts, say zizya, which to me means this person doesn't speak Arabic at all. Because no Arabic, with the 1 gram of knowledge, will write zizya. This is some, I don't know, from subcontinent, Indian subcontinent, or Bangladesh, or Pakistan, or some of this country, they would say zizya. And this is an idiot person who writes something that is extremely dangerous, and I pray to Allah to send him those people that are going to throw him in jail and teach him not to speak words that are bigger than his own mouth. So here this ayah of a safe, the sword, is a great, a huge problem. It's the biggest rock in anybody's shoes. My dear sisters and my brothers, Al-Islam is a religion that Allah, and as I said before, as the text of Al-Quran, Allah in Al-Quran says that anyone who believes in Allah and the last day of judgment, and the day of judgment, and does good, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there is no fear upon them. Yeah, my dear sisters and my brothers, anyone who thinks that the only in the 8 billion people that exist today on earth, and believe me, the Saudis, they believe this, and the creeps like them, they do believe in this, or what they call themselves, aka Salaafis, they believe that the 7 billion, thousands of millions, all of them are going to go to hellfire. The only people that are going to go to Jannah are Muslims. anyone who thinks this is complete doesn't know what the Quran is all about. Wallahi al-Azim. If people think today that all the Christians will go to hellfire, is a person that is not applying the teachings of Al-Quran. Allah in Al-Quran, whenever he says, لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ, those who have said that Allah is a third of the three, they have disbelieved. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about that there are people who they were born in Christianity. The only thing they know is Allah is three parts. These people, they will be questioned by Allah on the Day of Judgment. If these people believe in Allah and the last day and they do good and that is what they believe in, then Allah tabaraka ta'ala will speak to them. And it's not every Christian out there that you see is going to hellfire. Some people, you hear them say when they see a non-Muslim dead, they go, oh, alhamdulillah, I am a Muslim. It's kind of like, that's it. They have already ruled that person is going to hellfire. This is an ignorant act, because only Allah knows who died upon what they died. And so many people, you will find them with you in paradise, if we make it to paradise. Okay, you will find a lot of people in paradise that you thought were not going to make it, because you never ever thought about take time to read Al-Quran. Who will go to paradise? Who is the believer? What is Al-Islam? Al-Islam, and I will make a talk about this inshallah later on, Al-Islam in Al-Quran is not the Islam of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and you. Wasn't Jesus Muslim? Wasn't Ibrahim a Muslim? And if you think they were Muslims the way we are today, then you really, really need to study Al-Quran deep. Because Islam is three layers, and I will not get into them here. But what I want to say to this idiot who has written this, Islam is never respectful towards other religions, I will tell them, I pray to Allah to curb that tongue so that you never ever utter such lies. Because Islam is respectful towards others. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam let the Christians of Najran pray in his church. And also, weren't they the Jews living with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Al-Madinah nearby? Didn't they deal businesses with them? Anyone can come up with a hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam insults the beliefs of the Jews? And for your information, when Allah speaks in Al-Quran, Allah speaks always in fairness and truth. He always says, and amongst them. Not all of them, amongst them. The Jews were with Rasulullah ﷺ, and there were even some treaties between Rasulullah ﷺ and them. It's only when they betrayed the treaties that Rasulullah ﷺ cut the treaties, but they remained upon their own beliefs. Subhanallah, thousands of Jews at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ, they remained Jews. Did Rasulullah ﷺ tell them, you're going to hellfire, all of you, you're going to perish? He didn't. He interacted with them as humans, because that's the choice they make. That's the choice they will answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if anyone thinks that all the Jews that have existed since Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam till our time, all of them are going to go to hellfire, then this person has not read the Quran. Leave the hadith, the political influenced hadith. Many hadith are politically influenced. Many hadith Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say is just the scapegoat is Rasulullah. Anyone, as I said before, when they say, when we like something, we turn it into a hadith. Many people have turned so many things because politically at that time, there at the time Banu Umayyah or the Abbasi state or the Uthmani state, to give them justification to go and conquer and attack other lands, to them, oh, qala Rasulullah. That's the worst thing. Qala, Rasulullah said. What's this? That's why my dear sisters and my brothers, stick to Al-Quran. This person is a huge liar. Islam has always been respectful towards other religion. Al-Islam never belittled any other religion because people, so that to preserve the dignity and the value and importance of Allah's holy name. Al-Islam is truth, and other religion besides Al-Islam are falsehood. It's true, but only Allah decides who truly is a believer and who is not. There is a huge misconception, and you will see in the contradictions, wallahi al-azim, in the contradictions, you will scratch your head as to what, because if you don't stick to Al-Quran, assalamu alaikum. You'll end up like these Saudi scholars. For years, they messed up our religion. For years, they lied. As-Sudais, for years, they made dua against the kufar. For years. And then when politics changed, he started praising America, and now he's shaking hands with the Jews. I'm not against that. I'm very much, alhamdulillah, that we Muslims are now acting as we ought to be. People respectful towards the world. But because politics in the past, they were against the kuffar, so As-Siddis and his likes were against the kuffar. But now that politics and the king of Saudi Arabia and everybody is pro-America, Mr. As-Siddis and his likes are also pro-America. Where are the Saudi scholars today? Where are the protectors of the Tawhid today? Where is the Shaykh al-Islam's teachings of Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Taymiyyah? Where are those government-employed sheikhs today? It's because politics have changed. They have shut up their mouth because they do not stick to what Allah says in the Quran. They stick to what the school of thought says. How can someone say Islam and other religions will never be treated equally? Who said Islam? To you, Islam is what you believe in. But to someone who believes in Hare Krishna, his grandfather was a Hare Krishnian. His grandmother, for centuries, they have been a Hare Krishna. Do you think that's it? You go to him, believe in Allah, and the last day, let's see, a belief can change overnight. Rasulullah spent 23 years with Quraysh and they still didn't believe in him. 23 years! And you want people to change their religion in a day or two just because you tell them, oh, read the Quran is the truth. Why don't you read the Bible then and consider the truth? Because you believe that the Bible is not the truth. Well, guess what? The rest of the world looks at the Quran as not the truth. That's why they don't read it. How much do you know about, I don't know, what, any religion? Just like, subhanAllah, why this hatred? Why this hatred? Where does it come from? It comes from this Wahhabism, this bloodthirsty Ibn Taymiyyism. Ibn Taymiyyah in his book, subhanAllah, if someone does... They, in the first book of Al-Fatawa, take the big volume of Shaykh al-Islam, as they call him, which is not true. But anyway, as they mentioned it there, Shaykh al-Islam was asked the question, if someone utters the intention, I intend to pray Dhuhr for Rakat, things like that. What Mr. Ibn Taymiyyah says, we should tell him that it is a bid'ah, that he shouldn't do it. And then he says, I'm just like summarizing the whole fatwa. And then he said, if this person still carries on making the intention loudly, the person must be killed. SubhanAllah, we kill a Muslim for uttering something that you believe is an innovation, but they don't believe it's an innovation. So we go and kill a Shafi'i, because a Shafi'i says that you can make the intention loudly. So we go and kill everyone that has been a Shafi'i. The curse of Allah is still upon us for the last 14 centuries, and it will not go away unless and until we purify Islam from everything and put the Quran as the number one driver. No Bukhari, no Muslim. We only take from al-Bukhari and Muslim what agrees with the Quran or the Sunnah that are actions. Where Rasulullah, for example, Salat. There is not one single hadith where Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells us pray Dhuhr for Rakat. He just did it. And from day one, every companions, every single human has always prayed Dhuhr for Rakat and Asr for Rakat, Maghrib 3, Isha 4 and Fajr 2. No difference of argument, nothing at all. SubhanAllah, all these things. Why? Because Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did it. The companions, thousands of them, saw him how he did it. They all did as he did. The generations after them saw him, and entered. And let me tell you something. Wallahi al-Azim, if you chose to only take Al-Quran alone and those Sunnah act of Rasulullah, and you disregard the majority of the hadith, you are very well doing in Islam. Always remember, on the Day of Judgment, Allah will ask you one question. أَلَمْ تَكُنْ آيَاتِي تُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ Weren't my ayat, i.e. of the Quran, recited upon you? There will be no Bukhari on Judgment Day. There will be no Muslim on Judgment Day. And there will be no Ibn Taymiyyah on Judgment Day. And there will be no Abdul Wahhab. And there will be nobody else on Judgment Day. So my dear sisters and my dear brothers, always remember, Al-Islam is respectful towards other people. Other religion. We don't accept what they believe in. This is our point of view. Otherwise, who is protecting now the thrones of the kings of Saudi Arabia? Isn't it America and England? The inventions, the West is really far away. Medication and everything. Wallahi al-Azim, if I could find this person who has written this one, I'll make them eat their own words, because what they have said is absolutely a lie. Look at the horrible stuff. Islam is never respectful towards other religions and kufri isms. Why? And they just wrote the letter. Why? The cause, CZ, only Islam is truth and other religions are falsehood. When you say Islam, which Islam are you talking about? The Islam of Ibrahim? Yes. Musa alayhi salam was a Muslim. Isa Jesus was a Muslim. Ismail was a Muslim. Ishaq was a Muslim. Yusuf was a Muslim. His brothers were Muslims. It's just the ignorance about what Islam, and that Islam is explained in Al-Quran. Ya Allah, Ya Allah, I am far off from the lies of this person that says that Islam doesn't respect other religions. Your Prophet respected the religions of others. There is a difference from respecting and accepting. I respect your point of view. I don't accept it. This is what Islam is. It respects what you believe in and doesn't belittle it, doesn't insult it. But does it accept it? Absolutely not. I pray to Allah that this sheds some light about this big lie here, that this person here, a kafir is only allowed to live with Muslims when he has accepted the superiority of Islam. Wallahi, it's a plain idiot who has written and given zizya. Wallahi al-Azim, who has given zizya to Rasulullah? Nobody gave zizya to Rasulullah. Who has given zizya to Abu Bakr? Who has given zizya to Omar? It gets me boiling, these kind of people. Only then he gets equal right, but not equal respect like a Muslim. Wallahi, I pray to Allah to put you in a situation where you are so belittled until you feel smaller than an ant. And that will be Allah's punishment for the lies that you have uttered on behalf of Islam. My dear sisters and my brothers, I stop here, otherwise my blood is getting all boily. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us get rid of those ignorant people and protect us from the evil of such verdicts, because these verdicts, they will just make people hate us a little bit more than where we are already hated. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all. This is again your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanif, and I really sincerely hope that this person hears my talk. And if they don't agree, come and sit down and let's talk about it. Let me clean that brain of yours and take the brainwashing of Wahhabism. It's a dangerous gum. Alhamdulillah, now that the world is reacting and realizing that Wahhabism is at the root of all evil, and subsequently Ibn Taymiyyah, and bi-idhnillah, we will remove all this evil and go back to the Quran, to the beauty of the Quran, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mercy to mankind. A mercy cannot insult. A mercy cannot be disrespectful. A mercy, subhanallah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anyway, I pray to Allah to help us all. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp. 078-76-408735. And again, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.